In this video, we are going to discuss the poem Majuba Hill, composed by the poet Roy McNab. Roy McNab was born and educated in Durban and later studied at Oxford University in England. He served in the British Royal Navy during World War II. He was married to Rachel Mary Heron Maxwell and had one son and one daughter. He worked as a journalist, biographer, and editor of poetry anthologies. From 1868, he was attached to the South African Foundation in London. His poems appeared in Contrast, New Coin, and New Nation, as well as anthologies. Although this poem claims to describe the historical event that took place during the Battle of Majuba Hill, there are many inaccuracies. The actual battle took place on Majuba Hill near Volksrust during the First Boer War. Major General Sir George Pomeroy Colley occupied the summit of the hill on the night of 26 February 1881. It was a long and exhausting climb for the British soldiers who were unfamiliar with the terrain. Majuba Hill was not considered as scalable by the Boers for military purposes. Although the Boers placed sentries on the summit of Majuba Hill, due to poor communication, there were no sentries on guard during the night of 26 and 27 February. Colley's reason for occupying the summit remains a mystery. It may have been Colley's attempt to emphasize British power and strike fear into the Boer camp. 579 men with two cannons attempted to scale the mountain, but only 359 managed to reach the top, and no cannon. The poet accurately describes the British soldiers as arrogant, and their arrogance appeared to be the reason for their defeat. The British soldiers seemed invincible and safe on top of the hill. No efforts were made to secure the hill, and there was a cheerful atmosphere in the camp. Many of Colley's commands were ignored. Instead of following commands, the British soldiers relaxed in the warm African sunlight, oblivious of the counterattack planned by General Pitjubaar. According to the poem, the Woolly Boers used the cover of darkness and tree branches as disguise to climb up and attack the British soldiers in their sleep, in a sort of guerrilla warfare. The actual battle took place during broad daylight. The battle ended on 27 February 1881 at 6 o'clock at night. Three British officers and 93 soldiers died. Eight officers and 109 soldiers were wounded, and seven officers and 49 soldiers were taken prisoner by the Boers. On the Boers' side, only one man was killed on the battlefield. One later succumbed of his wounds, and five men were wounded. It was truly a resounding victory for the Boers. Now that you have a basic background of the actual events that took place on Majuba Hill, let's read the poem.
On the craggy mountain, top the mist, held a redcoat army in its fist. Beaten by arrogance and the sun, they dragged their last uncaptured gun to make a fortress of the hill and watch all night from the citadel. The creatures of the mist, the sheep, sniffed round the red men in their sleep. The only sentry still awake, who heard the yielding branches break. For the 5 days sleepless sentry stood, and snored at his post above the wood, while down upon the stirring plain, the night brought up its dunciness. The moon went skulking from the sky, and hid its face as the wood passed by. A few score Boer and bearded trees, scaling the mountain on their knees. The dawn rose up from an angry bed, drew back the shroud from the mountain head, and sent the sun out over the stones to gnaw at the sleeping soldiers' bones. The soldiers, sleeping in the sun, could never know what the night had done, how bitter were the blazing noons, the defeat in dust of proud dragoons. Only the nibbling goat and the sheep, saw how remote were the dead asleep.
The title of the poem gives the name of a hill, which then referred to the name of a battle during the South African First Boer War in 1881. Majuba Hill in isiZulu means the Hill of Doves and is situated in northern KwaZulu-Natal. The mood of the poem? Celebrating the victory of the Boers. The theme of the poem is a defeat of the British army by the Boers. Remember to try and memorize the theme of each poem, since they often ask the themes in the question papers. The narrator. The poet describes the incident, but notice that he tells us about this incident without any real bias. The poet is not on either side. He is merely telling what happened during this battle. Type of poem? This is a descriptive poem because it describes the events that took place during the Battle of Majuba Hill. It can also be seen as a narrative poem since it tells the story as well as a historical poem because it gives an account of a true historical event that took place. Let's look at the structure of the poem. This poem has 8 stanzas of 4 lines each in rhyming couplets, except for stanza 2 and 8, which each have 2 lines. The rhythm is regular. The structure gives an air of discipline to the poem, reminding us of the discipline of the British forces in their red coats, as opposed to the motley ununiformed Boers who oppose them. And yet, the Boers win this particular battle. The rhyme scheme is pair rhyme, AA, BB, CC, etc. Since there are a few military terms and other words being used in this poem that you may not be familiar with, I quickly want to go through the ones I think you might find most difficult. The military terms are Redcoat Army in line 2, which refers to the British Army. Uncaptured Gun in line 4. Uncaptured means not taken by force. In this case, it refers to the cannon. Fortress in line 5. A fortress is a military stronghold. Citadel, line 6. A citadel is also a fortress, but most often within a town. Sentries, line 9, is a guard, somebody who needs to keep watch. Dragoons, line 26. This refers to soldiers on horses. They are normally rough and fierce men. Let's have a quick look at some of the general words used in the poem. Craggy, line 1, means rough and uneven. Arrogance, line 3, is self-importance and pride. Yielding, line 10, to yield means to surrender or to give up. Dunsinane, in line 14, is a hill in Scotland mentioned in Macbeth written by Shakespeare. Skulking, line 15, to skulk means to keep out of sight, to hide or to conceal. Normally a criminal or a thief would be skulking. Score, line 17. A score is a group of 20. A few score, also in line 17, just means that there were not many, so it's rather counted in tens than in hundreds. Scaling, line 18, means to climb up, usually on hands and knees. Shroud, line 20. A shroud is a cloth covering a corpse. Gnaw, line 22. Gnaw means to wear away persistently, kind of like a dog when they chew on a bone, or a rat when they bite something. Noons, line 25, refers to the culmination point, in this case, the end of the British soldiers' lives. Blazing, line 25, blazing means very hot, but in this case, it refers to the blazing guns. Defeat, line 26, defeat means loss, or when you beat an opponent. Nibbling, line 27. Nibbling means to take small bites out of something. And then our last word, remote, in line 28. Remote means to be distant or far off. Let's analyze the poem stanza by stanza. Stanza 1 and 2. The situation is given in few words. The Redcoat Army, hidden by the mist, is on top of the mountain with their last gun. The word beaten tells us that they were almost defeated in the recent battle during the day, and have climbed the hill thinking it is a safe place to rest overnight. A fortress or stronghold, a citadel or fortified area, leaving one soldier on guard. We understand by the use of the word beaten that a battle has taken place in which the Boers managed to capture all but one of the British cannon, and the Redcoats had to flee up the hill to safety. Notice that the poet says it was arrogance and the sun that led to the British defeat in this battle. The British soldiers were not used to the harsh heat of the African sun. Also, their red coats made them very visible. In stanza 3, the soldiers sleep and only the wandering sheep are near them. The sheep are said to be the only sentries still awake, which tells us that the soldier on guard duty has fallen asleep. The last line hints at what is happening. The Boers are creeping up the hill, snapping the occasional branch as they come. The mention of the sheep indicates that the hill is far from a city, out in the veld. The men were so exhausted they were not disturbed by them, and none of them heard the movements of the Boers as they stealthily approached. In stanza 4, the sentry had no sleep for 5 days, as they had been fighting, and he fell asleep at his post. The plain, or veld, is stirring or moving, and the Boers are creeping closer, hidden by the night and the undergrowth. The reference to Dunsinane and the assumption that the reader knows Macbeth places this event on a level with this other stealthy creeping up on an enemy. It's Dunsinane means that the same thing is happening here as in Macbeth. In stanza 5, the night darkened as the Boers, just a small army of them, climbed the mountain on hands and knees. The reference to the moon skulking and hiding its face indicates that something shameful is about to happen. The idea of the Boers on their knees is in sharp contrast to the image of the British forces in their smart red uniforms marching in formation on the enemy. It makes the Boer killing of the British more of an achievement. The Boers themselves were usually bearded, but here the reference is to the trees, perhaps to the branches they held in front of them as disguises. In stanza 6, the morning arrived after an angry, violent night. The sun shone down on the bodies of the soldiers, the sleeping soldiers' bones. Dawn is personified as getting up from an angry bed, meaning that during the night the violence occurred. A shroud, in this case the shroud is the darkness of night, is the cloth wrapped around a dead body, which is fitting, as the light of day pulling back the darkness reveals the bodies of the soldiers. In stanza 7, the soldiers, now dead, could not have known what happened to them in the night. They would have been bitter at their defeat. Notice that the actual killing of the British soldiers is not told directly, simply alluded, hinted to, or at. It is said as if the night itself had killed them, but it was under cover of night that the Boers had ambushed them. Dragoons usually refers to soldiers on horseback, but can also mean infantrymen. In stanza 8, the final stanza of the poem, the dead soldiers were left on the hill far from any support or other British troops, with only the wandering farm animals about. Throughout the poem, the British have been said to be asleep, and here, dead, they still look as if they were sleeping. This tells us how they were killed in their sleep. Their remoteness from life and from the rest of their own troops is emphasized. As a final attempt to analyze this poem, we will quickly look at the poem line by line. Line 1. On the craggy mountain top, the mist. This line indicates the setting of the poem. Craggy means rough, rocky, or uneven. Mountain tip and mist is an example of M alliteration. Held a redcoat army in its fist. This is an example of personification. Redcoat refers to the red jacket the British soldiers wore. Redcoat Army is thus the British Army. Army indicates many soldiers, not just a few. There were more British soldiers than Boers. A fist is a closed hand. The mist held the British soldiers in its grasp. Beaten by arrogance and the sun. Arrogance means self-importance or pride. The British were a huge and well-trained army. They did not think that a few Boers could beat them. They were beaten by the sun because they were not used to the harsh heat of the African sun. In short, the poet offers three reasons for their defeat. 1. The British did not think that the Boers could beat them. They were too arrogant. 2. The British soldiers were not used to the harsh heat of the African sun. And 3. Their red coats made them very visible in the bright sunlight. They dragged their lost and captured gun. They had to drag the cannon up the hill, and it was difficult to do so. It was very heavy. The lost and captured gun refers to their lost cannon. The Boers had seized most of their military equipment. To make a fortress of the hill, a fortress is a military stronghold, and watch all night from the citadel, the guards were supposed to warn them. A citadel is a fortress within a town. This is a metaphor. Being on top of the hill, the English believed they were as safe as if they were in a fort, because they would be able to see the Boers as they climbed the hill, and therefore the Boers would be easy targets. The creatures of the mist, the sheep. The farm animals are grazing all around them. They were in a rural area. The reference to farm animals suggests how far the English were from any military support. Sniffed round the red men in their sleep. Red men once again refers to the red uniforms of the British soldiers. In their sleep, the soldiers were exhausted and fell asleep. The English were not alert. The sheep sniffed around them, yet they did not wake up. The only sentries still awake? The sheep were the only guards. Exhausted, the sentry fell asleep, and therefore the British were unaware of the Boers approaching. Who heard the yielding branches break? Yielding branches can have a literal or figurative meaning. Literally, the branches broke off to make way for the Boers, or the Boers broke off the branches to use as disguise. Figuratively, to yield means to surrender. The English did not stand a chance against the Boers. They had to give up. For the 5 days sleepless sentry stood. For the last 5 days the soldiers had no sleep. They were exhausted and could not stay awake. And snored at his post above the wood. The sleepless sentry in line 11 fell asleep and snored while on guard. To say someone snored while they were asleep is disrespectful. While down upon the stirring plain, the plain stirred because the Boers sneaked up on them, hiding behind branches. But they did not hear them. The night brought up its Dunsinane. Dunsinane is a reference to Macbeth. What is the comparison between Dunsinane in the play Macbeth and Majuba Hill? Both Macbeth and these British soldiers were on the top of a hill where they believed they would be able to detect the approaching enemy and kill them. Both Macbeth and these British soldiers were under the impression that they were safe, even untouchable by the enemy. Both the Boers and the army approaching Macbeth's castle broke off branches to disguise themselves. Both Macbeth and their soldiers were defeated by their enemies. The moon went skulking from the sky. The moon went skulking is a form of personification. It is as if the moon tried to keep out of sight in a cowardly way by trying to hide behind the clouds. The word skulking suggests that something shameful was about to happen. In other words, the moon concealed itself behind the clouds in a sinister manner as if to predict approaching evil and hid its face as the wood passed by. Because the Boers were hiding behind the branches, It looked as if the wood was moving. This is a metaphor. The boughs carrying branches as a disguise are being compared to a wood. A few score boar and bearded trees. A score is 20. A few score indicates to us that there were only a handful of boars. Boar and bearded is B alliteration. Bearded trees, the boars were bearded and the branches they carried make them look like trees. Although the boars had beards, this reference is most likely to the branches they held in front of them, which made them look as if they had beards. Scaling the mountain on their knees. Scaling means to climb a mountain on your hands and knees. The boars on their hands and knees can be seen in contrast with the British army marching. The dawn rose up from an angry bed. This is another example of personification. Dawn is personified as getting up from an angry bed. Angry bed shows that the night had been violent. Many English soldiers had been killed. Drew back the shroud of the mountain head. This is a metaphor. A shroud is a cloth wrapped around a corpse. The concealing mist was cleared by the heat of the sun to reveal the corpses of soldiers. The mountain head refers to the summit of Majuba Hill where the English were. And sent the sun out over the stone. Sent sun stone, another example of S alliteration. To gnaw at the sleeping soldier's bones. Gnaw means to wear away persistently. This is also a metaphor. The sun is being compared to an animal like a hamster or a rat that gnaws away at bones. The sun gnaws at the bones by drying out the flesh. The sleeping soldiers. The poet only alludes to the killing of the British soldiers, which means that the actual killing of British soldiers are only hinted, not told directly. They were killed in their sleep and still appear to be asleep. The soldiers sleeping in the sun. Once again, S alliteration being used. In this case, it emphasizes that the soldiers are dead. Could never know what the night had done. All of this happened under the cover of the night. The soldiers will never know what had happened because they were killed in their sleep. They did not realize what was happening. What the night had done? This is a form of irony. It was not the night, but the boers who had killed them. How bitter were the blazing noons? Bitter can have a literal and figurative meaning. Literally, it was a bitter thing, a horrible thing that happened. All those soldiers were killed. Figuratively, they died a shameful death, not a proud one. Blazing refers to the gunfire that killed them, the rifles of the Boers. Noons, this is the final point, the end of their lives. The defeat in dust and proud dragoons. Defeat, dust, dragoons. D alliteration. Defeat in dust refers to their shameful and embarrassing defeat. A dragoon is a soldier, rough and fierce men. Only the nibbling goat and sheep. Once again, this line indicates the rural area. Only wandering farm animals were around. So how remote were the dead asleep? This line emphasizes how far away they were from the rest of the British soldiers. Dead asleep, they were supposed to be watchful, but they fell asleep, and now they are dead. This concludes our analysis of the poem Majuba Hill. Please go through your extra notes and then answer the questions. Have a great day. Cheers, guys.